A very good morning to you students. Today we will do a new topic in grammar, that is poem appreciation, poem analysis or appreciation of a poem. Now what do you mean by appreciation? You understand what is analysis, that you are trying to find out in detail what is get more information about something. When you analyze something, you try to get more information in detail about whatever you are analyzing. Okay. Now, for example, you can say a situation. Maybe there's a fight between two children. Okay, and then you come to the teacher, and then the teacher analyzes the situation. In the sense, she will find out from each child what happened, how it started, what is the reason, was there any reason to fight, and then how the problem can be solved. Okay, so she's analyzing who did what. And how the things went ahead or maybe got worse, maybe for no reason at all. And then she will make the judgment. So it's the same way when you're talking of poem analysis or appreciation, you will analyze the whole poem. That is, you will look at the whole poem and find out or give information. Now here you have to write, okay, you will, whatever you find out, whatever your analysis are, your conclusions are, you have to write in the form of a paragraph, okay, and most of it should be a little bit in detail. I'll tell you which points, there are many points that have to be covered. As I teach you, I'll tell you which points have to be in detail and which are not necessary to be in detail. Okay. Let me just read. Appreciation or analysis is a careful and detailed examination of the poem's form, content, structure, language, rhyme scheme, etc. Okay. So you will see the form of the poem, what type of a poem it is, what is the content, the material, what is in it, the message that it's giving you, okay? The language, the structure, how the poem is, whether it's a very easy poem, the words that are used are old words, archaic words. So that's what you have to write. Sometimes the poem is very complicated, sometimes the poem is a very funny poem. Okay, the rhyme scheme, the central idea, all these points will come in your analysis. This is done in order to improve one's understanding of the poem. The language, that means the words and structure used in a poem, is very different from ordinary prose. Now this you know, that's why we even have figures of speech. So you don't have figures of speech in prose, but you have figures of speech in poem. So that's why the language and the structure, the way the poem is written, is totally different from the way you have your stories, that is your prose or your passages. Okay? Okay. Let's go ahead. Starting with the points that you have to remember. Now, here, it is very important because the points, each of these points have separate marks. Now, the whole thing comprises of 10 marks in your SSE board. So if you miss out a single point, you will be missing out on marks. Yes? Now, you see that you write each and every point, but then you don't have to write it point-wise. You have to write it in the form of a paragraph. Of course, you can divide it like how you write your essay. Yes, you divide your essay into two or three parts as depends on how long your essay is. Generally, your essay has to be of three parts. So here, you can divide your analysis into three parts. Yes, the first part. What will you write? Start your analysis with. First, you start with the name of the poem, the title of the poem, right? And then you go on to the second point, that is who has written or who has composed the poem. That is the name of the poet. So you say that the poem, so and so has been written by so and so. Okay. Or such and such poet. Okay. Now going on to the third point. the rhyme scheme. I just taught you a rhyme scheme. Or if you can elaborate a little more on the rhythm. Like sometimes there is a constant rhythm in a poem. Sometimes it's not there. It's just plain. It's just bland. But sometimes there's a nice rhythm where you feel like, you know, every second word, every second line rhymes. Yes. So it sounds nice. Or maybe the first stanza is a 5-line, second stanza 5-line, third stanza 5-line. Or the first stanza of 3 lines, third stanza of 4 lines, second stanza of 4 lines, third stanza 3 lines again, and the fourth stanza 4 lines. So that's what you will elaborate, tell in detail. Elaborate means tell in detail. Yes, not only will you tell that this is the, whether it has a rhyme scheme or no. Yes, sometimes some poems don't have a rhyme scheme. That time it's called a free or a blank verse, right? So you say the poem has a rhyme scheme. Or if it doesn't have a rhyme scheme, you say the poem doesn't have a rhyme scheme. It is a blank or free verse. Then also, if I told you, if there is a constant rhythm, you will mention it. If it's not there, you will not mention it. Okay? If the rhyme scheme is there, you have to mention if the rhyme scheme is there. Like supposing the whole poem, 1, 2, 3. All the 3 stanzas have A, B, C, D. So you will write there, poem has a rhyme scheme of A, B, C, D throughout all the 3 stanzas. If the rhyme schemes are different, you see the rhyme schemes are different for all the 3 stanzas. In the first stanza, it is A, B, C, D. Second, it is A, B, E, C, D, A, B, C, B. Third stanza, it is A, B, C, E, C, D, and E. Okay. So you are going to mention each rhyme scheme if it is different for each stanza. Yeah, if it's the same, you just say all the 3 stanzas of the whole poem has the same rhyme scheme, that is A, B, C, D, or whatever. And then I told you about the lines, the number of lines. Supposing it has constantly 5 lines in each stanza, that also you can mention. Now, very important is the central idea. This carries 2 marks. The central idea or the theme. First, you will tell the central idea of the poem. And then you will elaborate on it. Yes, you will expand it. You will tell it in detail what the central idea of the poem is. Don't just say the central idea of the poem is to forgive. Okay, that is the main point. But then elaborate a little more. To forgive even if we are angry, or forgive even our enemies. So you will not just write the central idea to the point. You will elaborate or write in detail about your central idea, because it carries 2 marks, or you will not get 2 marks for it. Clear? Even if you have written your central idea. Moving on to the next, that is the figures of speech. Now, you know, each poem has its own figures of speech. So here you will mention which figures of speech are there. Like supposing it has many figures of speech. So you will say the poem has a number of figures of speech, like. You will give the names of the figures of speech: alliteration, personification, synecdoche, repetition. But you will say alliteration is repeated the most. The figure of speech that is repeated the most is maybe alliteration and repetition. So you will mention both. If only alliteration is repeated very often, you will say the figure of speech that's repeated very often in the poem is alliteration. Okay. After writing that, you also have to give an example of the figure of speech that is repeated very often. Like supposing I said alliteration is repeated very often, you will give 1 example of alliteration with the explanation. Like say you give the sentence like the sun shines on a, the sun shines brightly in the sky. Okay, so you will give the explanation. The letter S is repeated for poetic effect. And if you're saying alliteration as well as repetition is repeated more often in the poem, then you will give an example of alliteration and its explanation, as well as repetition and its explanation. Clear? So you have to give whatever you feel is repeated more often. You have to give at least 1 example of it with its explanation. Clear? Okay. Okay, there's a slash at the end of the figures of speech. You don't write it, just omit it. Okay. Sixth point, your favorite line. So you have to mention which line in the whole poem you like. It can be just one line, it can be more than one line. That's why I've written line or lines. So you say, I like this line, or this is my favorite line. Mention, you have to put that in inverted commas, the line that you like the best. Okay, so you can say, and she helped her through her difficulties. If this is your favorite line, this line will be mentioned in inverted commas over there. And now, after you have written the line that you like, suppose you like more than one line, mention both. Then you tell why you like. First you tell why you like the first line, then you tell why you like the second line. You can say, I liked it because it shows that she was a very helpful person and teaches us to be helpful. That's the message the line gives us. A very positive message. Clear? So, if you like one line, write the quote the line there and explain it. If you like two lines, quote the line there and explain. Try not to write more than that. One or two lines is more than enough. Moving on to the seventh point, special feature. Now, special feature, there are many things in this, but not everything may come. Sometimes you can mention all the things that are there, sometimes not. Like, first of all, we tell what type of a poem it is, whether it's an inspirational poem, it gives an inspirational message, it's an imaginary poem, maybe a poem in fairyland, a funny poem where some comical things or nonsensical things are happening. Okay, then the meaning of the poem, what message is trying to give you, the style, whether it's a narrative style, means in the sense it's a poem where a story is being told. Yes, that's called a narrative poem. Yes, not just a poem. It starts with, say, a beggar, and it tells you about an event that happens in the beggar's life. That's the whole poem. It's like a small story. Okay, but it's written in the form of a poem. So that's called a narrative poem. Then the tone. What sort of a poem it is, whether it's a serious poem, whether it's a comical poem. Okay, the language, whether the language is very simple to understand, whether the language is difficult to understand, whether there are old or archaic words used, whether the language is direct or the message is very silent. Yes, it's not very prominent. Okay, then you can also mention the imagery, means if there are things that are imaginary in it. Yes, so then you have to quote the sentences. If you're mentioning it, you can quote the sentences. There are imaginary things, and like the example that I gave you, angels dancing. Okay, these are imaginary things, stardust sky. So it's giving you a vision. You can see something beautiful. That's why it's called the imagery, images. Okay, the images that it makes, the words that make your mind think of the images, okay, that you can imagine. That also you can mention. Now the last one is whether you like or you dislike the poem, and if you like the poem, why you like it, or if you dislike the poem, why you dislike it. So you will give reasons, like the examples that I have given you. Why you like, maybe it inspires. Why you don't like, maybe it gives negative vibes. Or maybe you don't like it because you find it too kiddish. Yes. Or it's nonsensical. It doesn't make any sense. Sometimes there are poems which make no sense. Yes. Now, I've explained the whole thing. There are a few points besides this that you should remember. Now, since it is written in paragraph form, the teacher correcting this may miss out on some points, and you will miss out on your marks in spite of having everything written, especially those who write it in a messy manner and, you know, make a khichdi out of it. You all don't leave a proper space between your words, or your writing is untidy. You may lose your marks in spite of having all the points. So what do? you will underline each point. Like when you said, I like the poem because, okay? So you will underline like the poem. So now the person correcting knows that you are talking about whether you like or dislike the poem, okay? Then you are giving a reason because the poem is an inspirational poem. So you underline the word inspirational. Oh, I dislike it, you underline dislike because it gives negative vibes. So you will underline negative vibes, yes? Then the name of the poem. The name of the poem is underline the name of the poem, yes? The name of the poet or the composer of the poem, poem is so-and-so. You underline the name. So each point, not the whole sentence, then again it's going to be useless. You will underline the main points where when the person just looks only and only at the main points, he knows whether you have written all the points or no, and you get your full marks. Is it clear? Okay. Now I want you all to read this at least twice. And I will just keep it on for you for a little while. I will, so that it's easy for you to write it. And this you have to write in your grammar notebook, because this is part of grammar. Now, in spite of writing this in your grammar notebook, you will write your poem analysis, that is the actual poems that you have, like you have written your poem and your poem figures of speech in your English notebook, correct? So whenever I tell you write your poem appreciation, you will write your poem appreciation in your English notebook, okay? But this note what I have given you, you will write in your grammar notebook. Is it clear? So you are going to complete this. Write this in your grammar notebook. And just remember the points that I have told you, that you have write it in paragraph form, divided into three paragraphs. Clear? So it becomes easy. Divided into three paragraphs. So it becomes easy to check your answer and don't forget to underline the main points. Clear? Okay. Thank you. Hope you have a good day.